aperture.
Okay. We did three projects together, Mati, Wall Street Stop, and the last book. Mati is about 10 years ago. I made for a design firm the annual report of the ROC. The ROC is a combination of 80 schools in the outskirts of Amsterdam. And after the annual report was finished, during the photography of the annual report, I was so intrigued by this new generation of students. I have to tell you that we have a lot of new immigrants in the Netherlands, people from Turk and Morocco and Surinams, and this changing, especially the population of Amsterdam. And now it was for the first time visible on those ROC schools that more than 50%, no, even more than 70% of the students were not from Dutch origin, but from origin from Turkey or from... So I wanted to make a reportage about this new generation. I went to the director, I said, this is a new phenomenon, I think we should make a book of it. And after some discussions, he found funds for the book and allowed us to start this project. For this project, I worked on it almost a year, and one day a week, I went to, always on Mondays, sometimes Tuesday, I went to the schools to make photos. In the beginning, the student didn't like me. Suddenly, this man standing in the hallway with his camera, and so I couldn't do so much. But then after a month, I became a part of the furniture. And they asked me to take a picture. Hey, meester, meester, meester. So they took me to certain positions and asked me to take a portrait or a group portrait. And this was the beginning of Hotmail and the digital camera. So I could send them the photo the same day. And that really was a big trick, because soon every student told to the other students, well, if he takes a photo of you, he can send it to you the next day. So this was nice to start with. After a few months, I told René, actually my wife sitting over there told me you should work, they were colleagues on the Rietveld Academy, my wife told you should work together with René with this project. I went to René with all my photos, and we started to discuss this project. And then I think, René, now it's your turn. Yes.
Okay, yeah. I will join a little bit this conversation. It's always interesting when a graphic designer is asked by a photographer to start thinking about a book and how to design a book or how to edit the material. And I think it's quite important in our conversation that we first were really looking at the material of Reinier. What kind of pictures did he make? How can you look at these pictures? Is there a kind of narrative structure seeable? Or how can you somehow find criteria to select all these pictures and to construct a good photo book? But at a certain moment, I think Reinier and I started to wonder a little bit, maybe it is good if this is a portrait of a new generation of students in Amsterdam. Maybe it's interesting to find out if there should be another layer of content into the book. And we were discussing this idea and thought, how can we do this and how can we organize this? And then we came to the idea, maybe it would be funny and also very interesting to start doing some workshops with the students from several schools together to let them make their own self-portrait. So what we decided is that we would ask the permission to do some workshops in these schools. So, and we got this permission, and which was very interesting because that was a logistic problem, of course. How can you organize that? That you can be two times a week in a class with students in between the program of the school. But they went along with this idea, and so what we did was somehow making a kind of assignment for them. So we made a kind of instruction about what is a self-portrait and how can you deal with this idea, and also a little bit what can you do, what kind of techniques would you like to use. So this was a sheet of paper we produced for them to be able to make a portrait with images they could make themselves, with a camera we have given them, but also with images from news magazines or from all kind of media they start looking at, with the idea that they could identify themselves a little bit as a character. And we were really curious what could come out.
Yeah, because on this part, they were allowed to glue or to write or there. And here is Ik Heet, as my name is. I am, and I'm on what part of the school, what I'm studying at the moment.
Yes. So
and here we shoot all like this.
So what you see here is in that sense the results of these workshops. We made a selection of that because we had finally we had over 100 of these self-portraits, which was for the amount a little bit too much for the book. And we thought, okay, let's make a good selection. So every time when we thought, okay, this is a good collage, Renier made us a portrait of the specific student. So this is a combination of the student and her self-portrait. And for instance, this girl, she has two nationalities. And she was trying to emphasize this in this collage. So she was partly Suriname, and she was partly, I think, Antilliaan. So this double culture was for her very interesting. But this guy, he had a lot of dreams. So he was really dreaming about having a family when he was old and also having a boat. So it's interesting to see how these youngsters somehow were identifying themselves with this project.
He wanted to have a boat and then show his kids how beautiful nature is.
Exactly.
That was the essence of his story.
I think this is a very good example of somebody who has a clear idea about what's
his identity. And this is a special, special story because those are all surahs from the Quran. And hidden between these surahs is one sentence, and it's killed the Jews. And this text was controlled by a teacher of the ROC, but he didn't control it so well. So suddenly there was in print this sentence. And this really caused some problems because the preface was written by Job Cohen, the mayor of Amsterdam. And he said, well, I can't have a book on the market with a sentence like that, so you should skip my preface. But the preface was printed on the backside of the cover, so we couldn't remove it. So and finally, we had to decide to add a sticker here, what says that the mayor of Amsterdam doesn't agree this Arabic text in this collage. Okay. She likes kids.
And how we present it now is not how the book is really set up, because if we had to design the book, we thought it would be good to make a combination of these two different layers of content. So in the book, you can see it also later after the talk, is that you see the pictures of Reinier, which is a portrait of this generation of students. But then in between, we have every time we mixed it up with these self-portraits. And this gives the book a certain dynamic. And also, it was the beginning of the digital era, so we had also to face some technical problems, because the first files Renier was making with his photo camera, they were not, in fact, suitable for this big format of the book. So we had to find out how we can make still a big book, because we wanted to make an A5 book. A book should be really a monument for this young generation. So we made all kind of test prints with the printer to see how far we could push the limit of the DPI. And I think some of these pictures, they have only about 125 DPI. So we tested it on different kind of paper. So in that sense, this collaboration between having the material of Reinier, start to think about the concept, to create yourself a new layer of content, and also to find out how you technically can produce the book, was quite an amazing adventure for us.
Yeah.
Well, so we go to the next book.
Oh, yeah, we go to the next book. Yeah. Wall Street Stop. This project, I wanted to make a documentary about the financial crisis. I started to work in Frankfurt, Paris, and London. most of bankers walking on the street and a pedestrian crossing, and well, it didn't work so well. So there I decided to go to New York, and I wandered around in the Wall Street day after day after day after day. And on the fifth or the sixth day, I took some pictures in the subway. And then suddenly I found out that's the place to shoot. So then I spent 10 days in your subway, and I took the line from Grand Central to Wall Street, and there I could see all the bankers. It was a rough time in New York. It was the height of the crisis. It was the end of the Bush era, and it was a very depressed city at this moment. So it was not hard for me to shoot this feeling of crisis in New York.
And when we were starting to talk about this book, then I was quite amazed because you can see that completely different than the book of Matti. The photograph of Rainier has developed enormously. So suddenly these pictures had a complete different kind of quality. It was not anymore a documentary photograph who made a lot of pictures and that you had to select them. He was almost making a new kind of pictures in which he was selecting all kind of moments and combining them together. So the material, the starting point for the book, was completely different than by the first book we made together. And then you have to take care about that aspect of the work as well. So how can you transmit that work into a book? The pictures became very broad landscape, almost panorama pictures. So you could not easily put them in a standard portrait book. So we had to find a different design for it. So we came up with the idea to make a landscape book, which felt very natural to the size of the pictures. But also, in that sense, this book was not, we didn't felt a kind of relevance for adding a new layer. It was more a matter about how to present these pictures in its best way, and how to make a good editing of the pictures. So we spent a lot of time printing these pictures out, making small thumbnails to put them on the table, because I think if you make a photo book as a graphic designer, also in relationship with a photographer, it's quite important to take these pictures out of the computer, because I think if you have to edit in the computer and you see these pictures on the screen, it's hard to get around to make some combinations. So what we always did, and what I always do in my studio, is that I ask the photographer to give me the files. I print them out in small sizes, in big sizes, and then we start making this way of editing. And I think this is a very intriguing and an interesting kind of conversation, because it's always about that a photographer has certain photos he likes the best, which maybe I, as an editor, I'm starting to doubt, is that a good picture, or maybe it's a good picture but not for the book. And that's also a different question. I mean, you can have good pictures, but not every picture is good for the book. And I think in this case we were more focused on the fact of editing the book and making a sharp and clean and good amount of pictures.
Yeah. But I think I should explain why they're panoramas. Yeah. I think you should go a few back. The white one, yeah, this one. In the subway, it's quite dark, and my depth of field is only a few inches. So my first shot in the subway, I had only one person in focus, and the other were out of focus. And then I found it was very simple to make a few shots in a short time, within a second. I take a few shots, tick, 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 of various persons. And then on the computer, on my screen, I combine these shots. So I'm in the subway with my camera. And because I shoot in a row, you get a wider panorama. On shot number one, I aim my camera at her. Shot number two, shot number three, shot number four, shot number five. So I have five digital files, and I combine them in the computer to one shot. And because I always shoot in a row, I go from left to right, that's why they become panorama. So.
Yeah, and I think because of this kind of method of working, we also decided that it would be very good that, let's say, in this book, that the margins of the book, there's not no white borders around. It's only white on the sides. So it's a little bit this sliding doors of the metro, which goes open and closed again, in which he makes in between the pictures. So this whole book is a little bit, the design is a little bit based on this kind of characteristic way of working, but also that it deals with the subject itself. And in between, there was a small text essay of Frits Geertsberg, and he was the curator of the photo museum in Rotterdam.
Rotterdam, yeah.
And he wrote a text about this photography of Reinier. Maybe you can explain.
And he compared it with Walker Evans. It turned out that Walker Evans in the 40s photographed on the same line, the Lexington line too, so between Wall Street and Grand Central. So these photos were shot on the same line. And this is Bruce Davidson in the 80s. Bruce Davidson has made the book about the subway. And Frits Giersberg has positioned my work between those photographers.
Yeah, and it's quite interesting to know that for me as a graphic designer, I have to be careful that I don't take over, let's say, with the design of the book, the quality of the photographer. I think as a graphic designer, I really believe that if I make a book with an artist or a photographer, that I try to understand the work of the artist, and that I, by talking about it and by discussing the work, you learn to see how a photographer, in this case Reinier, works. You learn to understand his motivations, but also you learn to see where the space is for a graphic designer to make decisions for the design. And in the first book, it was more adding this layer of content in which you organize a workshop. But in this book, it was much more finding that maybe the space in these typographical pages, in which this text essay is smaller than has a smaller page format size as the text pages underneath. But if you go to the pages in the images, they are only images, so they are not touched by any kind of let's say a design decision. And then you had the last book.
The last book. During the shoot of Wall Street Stop, I was already intrigued by people reading books, and I like the way they hold the book. I like the concentration in the eyes, the shoulders, and this in the incredible mass of thousands of people standing and walking on the platforms and in the subway. I loved it so much, so I had already hundreds of photos of people reading books. And then in 2009 or 2010, I found out that the amount of books were dwindling because the iPhone came in 2008, the iPad came in 2010, and in 2008, when I came in a car, I could see 20 or 30 books, and when I come in a subway car, now I see 3 or 4 books. So I decided I have to make a reportage about books that are read in the subway. And it's very interesting too, because this era is the era of the change from the analog to the digital world. And this visualizes this transition from the analog image to the digital image. So here we see people reading books. This was a great one. I saw him with his book, and he read it. I saw him, and then he put the book down so I couldn't shoot him anymore. And then he went out the train, so I followed him. He waited for 10 minutes on the platform at Union Square, and I kept an eye on him, and then he jumped on the 4, and I jumped on the 4 in the next door, of course, because when I'm too close, I can't shoot him. And then he turned his back to me, so I couldn't shoot him. And then at the next station, I ran to the other door, and finally, I could shoot this guy with Salman Rushdie. La vie est brève et le désir sans fin. That's a nice title. Okay, let's talk about the black yet. I decided to make two kind of photos. Close-ups of people just ahead in the book, and total shot of overalls or panoramas where you see not only the person reading the book, but the whole car. And René and I started already talking about the book, and we had already decided we're going to make these two layers in the book.
Yeah.
Yeah. And maybe you can show the next one. Yes. This is the first dummy. Photographers and designers like to make dummy. And I think that a book like this should be published by Aperture. So Marloes Kreijne of the Dutch Photo Museum, Foam, has sent an email to Leslie and said, Leslie, you should see this guy and his book. So I went about, I think almost 2 years ago, with this dummy to Leslie. And in this dummy, show something of the dummy. It's all sellotape and glue and paper and.
But also in this case, we had to find out a new concept for how to deal with the material. So we had these full color images, which were still in the method of documentary, and there was this black and white images, which were more like snapshots of people reading books, and that was a way for Rainier to collect as much as possible titles of covers for. Let's say for a documentation of readers or books. And in this first dummy, we tried to find out how we could combine them. How can we make a combination that it can work out without that it makes each other also a stronger, And you can here see, for example, that we made the black and white pictures page. Almost like as big as one page, and on the left side there was some information about it, and so this was really the beginning of the first dummy in which you try to make a combination between these two layers of photography.
I should give some credits to my daughter Sophie, who is a graphic designer, because René was very busy at that moment, and René said it has to be like this and like this and like this, and said it to Sophie, and Sophie made this dummy.
And there was this idea to see if there was a possibility to let some people writing about this topic, about the subject. And you can see that this was really like a first conceptual presentation in which you in fact make more clear how you want to build up the editorial structure of the book and how you could maybe see a kind of klimp, how it could be designed. But not really yet something which was balanced or which was thought through.
It's a very well-known Dutch writer, Pietje Puk. Oh, sorry. Pietje Puk is a very well-known Dutch writer.
For example, we decided to, because of the landscape format of the photos of Rainier, we thought maybe we could, instead of letting the photos going over the spine of the book, maybe we could do something with fold outs. Which is in that sense interesting because then you have you enlarged almost this feeling of a panorama. If you have two fold outs together, you make it really wide, the book. But at the same time, it's also very complicated. So it felt like an idea, but we were not yet sure if it was the right idea. It was a little bit like testing it out. And I think the only way to test it out is making these dummies and trying to see how they can work and how they balance the different layers of content. And in the back of the book, we came up with the idea to bring in a kind of index. And the index was a kind of overview of all the books you could find in the pictures. Also the title, the author, the publish house, the year of publishing, and also the ISBN. And this was also an enormous task to find all this information. And we had in that sense also the good help of Sophie to do that, to do so.
And then 3 months later, I came back in New York, and it was in the meeting room, conference room over there, and Leslie came in. He said, Rainier, I can tell you two things. One thing you will like and the other you won't. Well, I'll tell you first the thing that you like. Martin Parr saw the dummy and he liked it so much. He thinks it's a great project. But the second thing is, I'm very sorry, it's so expensive to do this production. It's not, we've discussed it here at Aperture, it's not possible to print this book for you. So I went, I was very glad Martin Parr liked it, but I was very disappointed that they couldn't print the book. But I decided, or we decided, and I decided to take revenge. So 4 months later, I was again in New York, and I gave Leslie a call. I said, Leslie, I have another dummy. Well, it's dummy number two. No foldouts. That's cheaper.
No, no, we skipped the foldouts, but it was also, I think, a good, you know, if you can digest a little bit your ideas, if you can let some time passing by over making a book, then I think the book can only become better. It's maybe a little bit of cliche, but I really think it is. And it was also hard to understand a little bit because this collaboration between me and Reinier is one part of the whole process of making a book, but also the publish house has ideas or has certain points of view which you have to consider seriously and take in to consideration if you start designing the book. And I think this is always a little bit difficult for, that sometimes it was a little bit hard for me to sit in Amsterdam and Reinier was visiting New York and was SMS texting me all kind of things or mailing me all kind of information which I could not really directly respond to, and that's sometimes a difficult position for me to be in Amsterdam. But we managed by making the second dummy, and
they begin to like it.
Of course.
Yeah.
We also decided to put the black and white pictures in an alphabetical order, and based on the author's name, so that the author's name became a little bit more important. But here you can still see that the title was there and the excerpt of the book was there. Also that the black and white pictures became smaller, so there's more white margins around it. But the idea of an alphabetical order, an idea of, an archive, was from that moment on became really a strict choice for the editorial structure. But we were a little bit discussing if we really should stay to the idea to have on every page one picture.
Because I already thousands and thousands of pictures. Yeah. And on this way, only one page, the book would be too thick. And I was very sure Aperture was not going to pay a book that thick. So that's why I've decided to have 6 or 8 authors on the spread.
And still
and
with index.
And the index. And then came the third dummy. Well, and then we wanted to Rene wanted to join me to New York, but it was too busy and no time. And so we've decided to make a little video in which we recapitulated the design of the book.
Yeah.
We're going to show it 7 minutes or 8 minutes. So here we go.
This is René Put, graphic designer from Amsterdam. We work already together for 10 or 12 or 14 years. This was our first project, the award-winning book Matti. Our second project was Wall Street Stop, published by Hartje Kans about 3-4 years ago. And the project we are working now on is called The Last Book. I started it in 2011. This was the first dummy. I showed it to Leslie Barton. She even told me Martin Parr liked it very much. We've been working on this dummy and dummy, and again, we've been working and working, and finally we came to this dummy, and René, it's his profession. He has to present this book, our final dummy. René, come on.
Okay, thank you, René. The book is called The Last Book. This project is about Reinier photographing people in a subway, reading books over and over again. He makes photos and more photos and even more photos. But he makes two kinds of photographs. He makes photographs which is typical Reinier's profession, his, where he is famous about, is documentary art photography, in which he makes interesting combinations of compositions with people standing, living, sitting in the subway, reading books. These are for color images, which are mostly landscape size, but he also snapshots almost people just reading books to make a kind of collection, to build a big archive of images in which people read books, and he wants to collect as much as possible titles over the years and time he is spending in New York to make us aware about this, these beautiful titles of
and
books.
It's to show, because the printed book is dwindling. There are still a few printed books in the subway, but 5 years ago everybody was reading a book, and now because of the iPads and the tablets, this is changing. And within a few years there will be no printed books anymore. But that's why we've chosen this size. Well, it's the size of a novel, the size of a classic novel.
Yeah, because when we were thinking about the design of the book, we had of course to find some starting points for the design and the structure of the book. So one of the starting points was maybe it's good to have a reference to the classic novel, to the classic literature of America. So that means maybe binding it as a hardcover, finding a dust jacket around it, binding it in a book clasp which is really strong and which can stand for a long life, but also maybe the choice of paper is relevant. But I think let's show us what we have done with the book as well. So when you find the book, this is the cover in which you already see that we made a reference to literature. This is the typical penguin series you have developed in America. I think they are all over the world famous. So it's an interesting reference to books as well. This just jacket, you can take it away, then you find a hardcover book with the title on top of it. It's bound in the coated book cloths, which is very strong, so it's perfectly for archiving it. It lasts forever, indeed. Yeah. But then we came to the structure of the book. These two different parts of photography, we had to combine it somehow. And we divided the book in that sense in different parts. So you have three parts with the full-color photography, and you have two parts with the archive based on alphabetical order. And we changed those parts in the structure.
So it's one part my color photographs, then one part archive A to N, again the color photographs, and then a archive part M to Z.
Exactly.
And then color photos again.
And then color photos again. And to give you a small impression how that would look like in the book, we thought, now let's make a perfect dummy. It's also good for us, so we can understand if we made the right decisions.
It's also the last dummy.
It's hopefully the last dummy for the last book, of course. As you can see, this is the cover. We have chosen for simple black end pages. Then you start with the French title, it's very classical. Then you have the real title page with the title of the book and the author and the publisher. And then we start with a small essay which has to be written by the author about this project. I flip through very quickly because it's most important, of course, to focus on the photography of Rainier. This is how a section of these full color images will start. You get a list of all the titles Rainier has photographed in the subway in his documentary art photography.
Here we go on and go on. And go on. This is a section of 15 shots, and at the end of those 15 shots, we get
you get the archive. And we must also make a distinction between the print quality. So what we do is we print the full color images on coated paper. It's a high quality art paper, so it's mostly used for catalogs and photo books. And we print the section with the alphabetical order with the archive. We would like to print it on uncoated paper, referring again to the novel, books of novels. So it's a different tactility in how you can experience the book. But besides of that, we were discussing a little bit if we should print this archive in black and white, or that we should make even more a distinction between the black and white and the four color images. And we thought it would be much better to push that so far as possible. So what we decided is to print the whole archive with all the titles based on alphabetical order from A to Z in a beautiful strong cream color. So it's interesting because then it's more like a conceptual approach of how you can deal with an archive. So it has not to be seen as black and white photography. It's more a collection of all these titles which are disappearing as books in, let's say, physical paper books in the subway. And to interchange that with the sections of the full color photography of Rainier, you get an interesting book, because then you have first the full color images, which is attempting you to experience this special photography. But then you get curious maybe by the alphabetical order to see more titles and also to find back the titles which he has photographed in the full color in the alphabetical section as well.
And what about this jacket, René? Tell me, there's something about the dust jacket.
Yeah, it's because
it feels a little bit thick. This is a dust jacket. What can we do with this dust jacket?
Okay. To emphasize a little bit on this concept of a book, and to emphasize a little bit on the fact that these books are, let's say, disappearing, we thought, okay, if you make a dust jacket, normally a dust jacket is just one folded paper around the book. But we thought, why not make a dust jacket which is a little bit more dealing with the topic, with the subject of the last book. So we thought it would be very funny and very interesting to make a dust jacket which is in fact one big folded sheet in which you find several covers, or let's say archetypical covers, which are referring to classical novels as well. So we have already The Penguin, but we could also play with science fiction book. So suddenly the last book becomes a science fiction book. Or we could play with all kind of different kind of archetypical cover designs used in book design, and playing with the idea that this is of course a book about photography, but it deals with the subject of literature and with the subject of the disappearing book. So also covers are important for us, at least.
This is a nice end of our story.
I think so.
And it's a beautiful cover, too.
Yeah. It's a little bit a quick presentation to give you a little bit of an idea how we work together and how we came to these kind of decisions. But we really hope that you will understand them, and for all the details about specific paper and color and how it would be possible. We have considered that as well, of course. I mean, it's all possible to print it and to bind it very easily and very simple. So I think that's a little bit our presentation for today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This video, it was decided immediately that they were going to publish the book. That's, yeah. Well, what are we going to show now? I think the book itself, isn't it? Oh, this was at the printer. It took days and days. It was printed in Istanbul, very good printer. And we don't have so many photos of it. And René found this photo. Yeah, that's me, almost asleep. Okay, next one.
Okay,
we're going to show some photos of the book itself.
Yeah, that's also something you can see here on the table, because then you really can see and feel and understand a little bit what we have designed together.
Yeah.
But to give you an impression,
I think we should just click on it.
Click on. But I think altogether with making all the dummies, I think it was about 3 years of work.
I think 3 years, yeah, 2.5, yeah. Okay, the last book, and then I almost forgot. The dummy was at the Unseen Photo Fair about a year ago. It was at the booth of Julie Sol Gallery, and we have in Holland, we have the Mondrian Foundation. And the Mondrian Foundation works very close together with Paradox, and that's a foundation that starts photo projects in the Netherlands. And Bas Vroeger of Paradox saw this dummy, and he said to me, Rainier, it's nice that you're showing the fact that books are fading, but you should tell more about the future and the apps and the digital. Well, we started the discussion, and after 2 weeks, he said, Rainier, we're going to make an app. And this app will be about digital, about the tablets. So now I have a book about books, and now there's a tablet about tablets. So if you have an iPad, you can go to the iTunes store. It costs you $5.95, and you get the last book, Revisited. So we're going to show now a few pictures of the last book, Revisited.
And therefore, we took the same design as for the printed book, but we changed some of the decisions in, for example, here the color blue was in the book, in the printed book it was dark green, and we even took now more the screen color of blue. But the structure is further on completely similar to the printed book.
I'm sorry? You don't know what in Reno. It was quite boring to shoot it. Yes, yeah. Okay.
This is the final image.
Well, it's it. Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm signing books, and I'm sure you all want to buy one, two, or three books. That's possible. I'm sitting over there and signing the books. Are there questions? I'm sorry?
Yes, I have a question.
Yes.
How much of your criteria for what ended up in the book had to do with what the book was that was being read? Or was it, is it just, is the whole picture? I mean, to what extent did you pay attention to the title of the book?
Actually, if I do get your question right, I wanted to, I'm sorry?
To what extent, when he was editing the book, when he was choosing the pictures he was going to put in the book, was he paying attention to the books that were being read in those pictures? Because many of them appear to be quite classic. And, you know, so that's my question.
The book consists of two parts, the color panoramas and the black and white shots. The color panoramas, I think I like the title, but I'm more intrigued by the characters, the way they look, the way they pose. This is an image of New York in 2015, 2014. So, and for the black and white pictures, I've shot more than 1,000, and I found it very hard to select. During my shooting, it was quite easy. Only people who held the book upright or quite upright, so I could see it, and I wanted to see the front of their face. But then I still had 800 photos that met those criteria. And then I sent the whole bunch of 800 to Aperture, and they have found a kind of group to make the selection. So maybe people from Aperture can answer this question. I can't. They've made a selection. Do you know Leslie?
Yeah, well done.
Authors. Yeah, it was various criteria. Yeah, a document of our time. I think that's the main basis or the main criteria. Yes. Yeah. More questions. Da, 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 da. Leslie.
Can you talk about
thank you.
In terms of the longer panoramic images that were in the foldouts, I mean, obviously you were selecting the ones that were a little less long for the current format of the book. So how many, or were there some pictures that you either changed or decided not to use because of that?
Well, that became the first dummy of the first, our first thought about it was a large book. And then because there was a book about books, René and I decided it has to be the size of a novel. And when you open a novel, it only is possible to have a certain size. When the photo would be more panorama, it would be much smaller. Yes, I changed the selection. Some photos I cut off, and after half a year, I decided to make them less wide, the panoramas.
And it was also.
Yep. Yes, I cut the pictures to make them fit. Yeah.
So that's okay. Yeah. But in the book Walls Street Stop, it didn't. In the book Walls Street Stop, the pictures, the panorama pictures, were used in the size and scale how they were photographed by Rainier. But for this book, we indeed had to force a little bit the photography into the format size of the book.
How did you take the pictures in the subway? Very openly, or in a way hidden? Did you meet hostility?
It's not easy. And always when I came in New York, the first day, I find it very hard to point a camera at someone and take a picture. It feels uneasy. So always on the first day, and the second day, I make some shots and I hide myself too much and do it from a big distance. But then you see in the evening, you see what you've made, and then you say, Rainier, you have to come closer. And then after 2 days, I come quite close, and it's at this distance that I shoot. I do it very quick. My camera is here. Click, 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 and then the camera is down again. And when people see it, I always have a note in my back pocket that explains my project. And in this way, the last book project was much easier, because during the project of the Wall Street crisis, I really felt uneasy. And that's one of the reasons why most of the shots were shot from the platform, but now I was in the car, so you're very close to people. And if they protested, I showed them this little note, and then I always got a smile. They liked it always. And only a few people wanted their picture to be erased, so I erased them. And I worked for this project for 13 weeks in a subway, and there's only once someone wanted to molest me. But I could see in his eyes that he has used certain things, so it had nothing to do with me, just with, yeah. Well, in general, people are very polite in New York. When you do this in Holland, it would be almost impossible. Yeah. Is that your answer to your question? Okay.